Good afternoon. I want to thank those of you for coming to this related to the Newton officer-involved shooting that occurred on June 15th, 2017. I personally want to thank the Newton Police Department, Chief Michael Jewett, who has been very accommodating to us to allow this here, also as well as the school for allowing us to host it in this room. It is very important for us to come to the community where these events transpired. You'll be hearing from the following: Attorney General Gordon J. McDonald, Senior Assistant Attorney General Jeffrey Strelzin, as well as Colonel Chris Wagner of New Hampshire State Police and Colonel Richard McEwen of the Massachusetts State Police. We'll be giving a 30-minute presentation on the events that transpired in both Massachusetts as well as a short time in New Hampshire, and that resulted in the death of Michael Brown. I'm first going to set up a few ground rules very briefly. First, if you would, please put your cell phones on vibrate. Secondly, at the conclusion of the presentation, we'll be given an opportunity to ask questions, and I would ask that you hold your questions to the conclusion of the events. Additionally, we will be providing a copy of not only the presentation, which you all will be seeing, as well as the written final report. With that, Attorney General Gordon McDonald.
Good afternoon. Law enforcement officers are granted special authority to use deadly force in the course of their duties to keep our community safe. With this special authority comes an obligation that officers are accountable for the use of that force. As Attorney General, it is my responsibility to ensure that whenever a law enforcement officer uses deadly force, the officer's actions are in conformity with the law. Today, we are releasing the report of investigation and conclusions with respect to the use of deadly force by four Massachusetts state troopers just before midnight on June 15th here in Newton. The incident resulted in the death of Michael R. Brown, age 40, of Presque Isle, Maine. I believe that to the extent possible, it is important to be directly accountable to the communities most immediately affected by incidents such as this, hence our presence in Newton today. And I would like to reiterate our thanks and acknowledge the support of Chief Michael Jewett and his department, the school, and the citizens of Newton. Under New Hampshire law, a law enforcement officer is justified in using deadly force when the officer reasonably believes that such force is necessary to defend the officer or a third person from what the officer reasonably believes is the imminent use of deadly force. Following a thorough investigation by my office and the New Hampshire State Police Major Crimes Unit, I have determined that the use of deadly force by the four Massachusetts state troopers was legally justified. The troopers are Michael Caranfa, Robert Holland, George Katsarakis, and Daniel Pertell. The details and legal bases for this conclusion are set forth in a 29-page report that we are releasing today. In sum, and as you will be seeing and hearing today and reading in our report, here are the following major facts. Mr. Brown had been wanted in Maine for a charge of gross sexual assault. He was reported to have stolen a truck along with a loaded 9mm handgun with a 15-round magazine. Shortly after 11 o'clock on June 15th, Malden, Massachusetts police observed the truck. They deployed a spike strip in an attempt to disable the truck. Although both passenger tires were shredded, Mr. Brown did not stop. A dangerous pursuit ensued, during which Mr. Brown drove erratically and at a high rate of speed. He turned on and off his headlights. He threw items from the truck to the pursuing Massachusetts state troopers. He fired gunshots at those troopers. He crossed a median and drove the wrong way on Interstate 95 and the wrong way on an off-ramp. And on a residential street, he almost hit an incoming car. He crossed the New Hampshire state line, and shortly thereafter, less than 2 miles, he came to a T intersection where Amesbury Road meets Bear Hill Road here in Newton. When attempting to turn left, Mr. Brown lost control of his truck, and at that point, the troopers got out of their cruisers, weapons drawn. Mr. Brown ignored verbal commands, and instead, he revved the engine of the truck and accelerated towards several troopers with his arm extended, holding a silver handgun. The troopers fired. Mr. Brown suffered a single gunshot wound to the neck and died immediately. Mr. Brown's dangerous and potentially deadly actions prompted the troopers to fire. As set forth in detail in the report, based on the facts and circumstances known to the troopers at the time, that use of force was reasonable. I'd like to now recognize Colonel Christopher Wagner of the New Hampshire State Police.
Thank you, Attorney General. I am Christopher Wagner, Colonel of the New Hampshire State Police. I want to be clear about the transparency and the thoroughness of this investigation. I have the thanks to the Major Crime Investigators Unit of my agency to thank for that. The investigators within the Major Crime Unit are some of the most experienced and knowledgeable, dedicated employees, and I simply want to thank them for their dedication, their diligence, and the resolve to get this investigation done as swiftly as possible. I want to recognize Colonel McEwen from the Massachusetts State Police. Massachusetts State Police and the New Hampshire State Police have a long-standing relationship, as we do with all other New England State Police agencies. I am and my organization are appreciative of our professional relationship we have across the borders, and I want Colonel McEwen to know that. I also want to recognize the heroic efforts of the Massachusetts troopers that evening in New Hampshire. With public safety in mind, putting their own safety at risk and at peril, they performed their duties with courage and heroism, and they should be commended for that. Having said that, I will turn it over to Colonel McEwen.
Thank you so much, Colonel. Appreciate it.
Good afternoon, everyone. I'd like to take this opportunity to thank Attorney General McDonald and his many assistant attorney generals for their thorough review of all the facts and circumstances of this incident, including the suspect's dangerous actions, which jeopardized the lives and safety of the public and our troopers. I'd also like to publicly thank New Hampshire State Police Colonel Chris Wagner for his leadership and cooperation on this particular matter and on the many issues upon which we regularly collaborate. Massachusetts State Police were always confident that a full examination of the evidence would indicate that our troopers had no choice but to use lethal force to end the deadly threat posed by this armed and reckless suspect. I commend the troopers whose actions were the subject of the inquiry by New Hampshire authorities. They acted decisively with bravery and in full accordance of the rigorous training that they have received on use of force. I also commend those troopers and every other Massachusetts State trooper involved in this incident for the stellar tactics, discipline, and tenacity they exhibited throughout the long pursuit of this dangerous suspect. I'm grateful for the work of all of our personnel who put their own safety at risk to end a dangerous threat to the public. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Senior Assistant Attorney General Jeff Strelzin of my office, who heads our homicide unit, led this investigation along with State Police Major Crime. I will now turn the program over to Senior Assistant Strelzin, who will lead us through a presentation of the events that day including some of the video and audio evidence that was obtained during the investigation.
Good afternoon. The events that led to the shooting in Newton, New Hampshire on June 15, 2017 actually began in Presque Isle, Maine about a week earlier. Presque Isle, Maine, as you can see on the map, is about 5.5 hours north of Newton, New Hampshire. On June 6, 2017, a 16-year-old girl told a family member that she had been sexually assaulted. The next day, on June 7th, the sexual assault was reported to the Presque Isle, Maine Police Department. The victim said that the assaults had occurred on June 3rd and 4th, 2017. She told the police that she knew the person who had assaulted her, and that person was Michael R. Brown, Presque Isle, Maine. A few hours after the sexual assault was reported to the police, a Presque Isle police detective reached out and called Michael Brown about the allegations. The detective told Mr. Brown that he wanted to speak to him and get his side of the story. Mr. Brown said he was at a job site, but he refused to say exactly where he was. The detective told Mr. Brown that he'd call him later on that day to set up an interview to talk to him about the allegations. After that phone conversation, the detective got a call from Mr. Brown's girlfriend. She said that she'd been texting Mr. Brown and that he had told her he was not going back to prison and that he was suicidal. Now at that time, Mr. Brown already had a criminal record and had been to prison before, which is probably why he made these statements. Later that day, Mr. Brown contacted his girlfriend again and told her that he had actually tried to commit suicide that day. In the meantime, while that's happening, the Presque Isle police were working hard to try to locate Mr. Brown. Not long was speaking to him, the detective reached out, spoke to the employer, tried to find out exactly where Mr. Brown was. The employer knew where he was working, but said that Mr. Brown had left the job site not long after the detective had called to talk to Mr. Brown. The employer also said that Mr. Brown had not returned to the job site that day. From that point on, for about the next week, the Presque Isle police tried to locate Mr. Brown. They were not successful. Some of the things they did were issue a BOLO, which is an alert to law enforcement, asking for their help in locating Mr. Brown. The police also spoke to some of Mr. Brown's relatives to try to find out where he was, but they were not successful. Finally, the detectives also pinged, which means they sent a signal to Mr. Brown's cell phone to try and locate the phone and locate him. Despite all those efforts, the police were unable to locate Mr. Brown in the week following the report about the sexual assault. On June 14th, though, the police did receive more information about Mr. Brown's intentions. His girlfriend told the police that she'd heard from him the night before. He told her, at least she said he told her, that he was no longer suicidal, but he'd left the area. However, later that same day, the police got conflicting information. One of Mr. Brown's relatives told the police that he'd said that if he got caught, he would be looking for the police to kill him. Mr. Brown also said that he was not going to go down without a fight. And he was specific, he said the police will be killing him. Once the police had that information, they put out an updated bulletin to law enforcement, warning them about these statements from Mr. Brown and telling law enforcement that he planned to commit suicide by cop. The next day after that bulletin was released, Mr. Brown came out of hiding. On June 15th, he stole a Toyota Tacoma pickup truck from his uncle in Westfield, Maine. Westfield, Maine is about 15 minutes south of Presque Isle, Maine. Mr. Brown not only stole that pickup truck, he also stole this, a Fratella 9mm semi-automatic pistol. The owner of that pistol said that at the time it was stolen, it was loaded with 15 live rounds. The police were notified about the theft of the pickup truck and the theft of the gun at about noontime on June 15th. Later that day, they issued another BOLO, another alert to law enforcement. And in this alert, they advised law enforcement officers that a temporary warrant had been issued for Mr. Brown by the Presque Isle Police Department for gross sexual assault. The bolo also contained a physical description of Mr. Brown and told law enforcement that he was driving a 2001 Toyota Tacoma pickup truck and that it contained a stolen 9mm handgun loaded with a 15-round magazine. After that bolo was put out, the police took some additional steps to try and find Mr. Brown. That included pinging his cell phone to try and locate it. They were successful. At about 8:30 p.m. on June 15th, Mr. Brown's cell phone was pinged in Hampton, New Hampshire. At 10 p.m., his cell phone was pinged again. This time, it was about an hour south in Malden, Massachusetts. At 11:10 p.m., the Malden police spotted Mr. Brown in the stolen Toyota pickup truck, and they reported that he was not stopping and they were pursuing him. At 11:18 p.m., a Massachusetts state trooper tried to stop Mr. Brown on Route 114 in Andover, Massachusetts by using spike strips to shred his tires. The spike strips did their job and shredded both of the passenger side tires in Mr. Brown's truck. That meant that from that point on, he was driving on just rims on the passenger side of his truck. However, Mr. Brown did not stop. He continued fleeing from the police, and at 11:22 p.m., he drove out onto Interstate 495 North. At that point, several Massachusetts State Police troopers took over the pursuit, and they followed Mr. Brown as he headed north. The pursuit would end up lasting about 30 minutes from the time Mr. Brown got onto I-495 until it ended in New Hampshire. During that time, a Massachusetts State Police helicopter also assisted in the pursuit. We've obtained a copy of the helicopter's audio and video recording from that pursuit. That's the only video recording we have of the events that took place that evening. None of the troopers involved in this pursuit had body cameras, and none of the cruisers had video recorders. We'll be releasing a complete copy of the helicopter's recording today at the end of this proceeding, along with our written report about the incident. For now, though, we're going to show you 9 clips from that recording, which depict portions of the pursuit and the aftermath of the shooting. We want to be clear, there is no video of the shooting incident itself, and I'll explain why. The Massachusetts State Police helicopter that recorded some of the pursuit was crewed by 2 people, a pilot and a tactical flight officer. The pilot's job is to fly the helicopter. The tactical flight officer's job is to monitor the suspect, monitor the law enforcement officers in the pursuit, and keep an eye on traffic and any potential obstacles or hazards that come along the way. While the tactical flight officer is doing that, if he has time, he can also try to record some of the pursuit. In this case, that was done with an infrared camera system mounted on the helicopter. That system uses the difference in temperatures on surfaces to generate a black and white image of the target. Unlike TV or in the movies, you'll see that this system cannot see through objects or into things. In addition, this is a 15-year-old system. That means it's unlike some of the newer systems that are available, this system on this helicopter could not automatically track its target that night. Instead, the tactical flight officer had to manually use a console inside the helicopter and amongst his other duties, try and track the suspect as the pursuit happened. That's why in this case, as you'll see, only portions of the pursuit and some of the aftermath of the shooting incident were captured and recorded. However, as you'll see in here, the recording did capture radio transmissions between the troopers and the helicopter that night. And you'll hear some of those on these clips today, as well as the recording you'll get at the end of the presentation. I'll give you a brief explanation before every clip so you understand what's coming. In the first short clip we'll play, you'll see the view from the helicopter, give you an idea of how it looked, and you'll also hear a trooper report that Mr. Brown is throwing items out of the truck as he drove up 495. In the next clip, you'll hear a trooper report that Mr. Brown has fired shots at them out the window of his truck. He's firing the shots out of the driver's side window. This is the first of 6 times that you'll hear a trooper report that Mr. Brown is shooting at them during the pursuit.
Shots fired out the window, driving the window.
In the next clip, you'll see Mr. Brown's truck on 495 headed north being pursued by several troopers. You'll also hear that Mr. Brown is throwing more things out of the truck. This clip will also demonstrate the limitations of the helicopter's camera system. You'll see how things like trees and other structures like bridges can block its view of the target. This is Mr. Brown's truck in the crosshairs. In the next clip, you'll hear that Mr. Brown is again firing at the troopers. This time, he's firing out of the center back window of his truck. In the next clip, you'll see the helicopter's camera zoom in on Mr. Brown's truck. You get a better view of it. You'll actually be able to see on the passenger side that both of his tires are gone and he's riding on the rims. In the next clip we'll play for you, you hear that Mr. Brown is again firing shots out of the truck at the troopers. The next clip we have describes one of the more dangerous moments of the pursuit. The clip captures the moments after Mr. Brown has crossed over the median strip between 495 and 95 and begins driving the wrong way. He's headed northbound in the southbound lane on I-95. You'll hear that the Massachusetts State Troopers do not follow him across the median and instead rely on the helicopter to keep track of him. You'll also see Mr. Brown heading down a ramp onto the highway going the wrong way. A short time later, you'll hear that he shut off his headlights while driving northbound in the southbound lane. And not long after that, you'll see him go the wrong way on an exit ramp, and almost lose control of his truck. At that point, he exits the highway onto Route 286 in Salisbury, Massachusetts, where the pursuit continued and eventually up into New Hampshire.
Shut it. his headlights off. He's still northbound in the southbound. Looks like he's in the far right lane, actually.
You'll see him on the ramp in a moment. In the next clip, you'll see Mr. Brown being pursued on back roads as he drove from Massachusetts and then briefly into New Hampshire. You'll hear a trooper report that Mr. Brown has shot at them again. You'll also hear the trooper behind Mr. Brown report that he tried to bump the stolen truck and stop him, but was unsuccessful. That trooper also reports that Mr. Brown fired at him, and the trooper fired back. The clip you're about to see takes place about 3 minutes before the pursuit ends in Newton, New Hampshire. That's the cruiser behind him trying to bump him. You heard the trooper there say he was unable to pit him. It wasn't hit him. Pit is pursuit intervention technique. Just basically he was trying to bump him to try to get his car to go sideways and stop the pursuit. The next clip we have for you is the last one we'll be showing today. This is the longest clip. It's 3 minutes and 45 seconds long, and it captures the time just before and after the pursuit passes into New Hampshire. The pursuit continued for only a mile and a half into New Hampshire before it ended. In fact, from the time the pursuit crossed the Mass line until the shooting happened and it ended, it was only about a minute and a half. You'll hear a trooper on this clip warn the others to use extreme caution and tell them that Mr. Brown has what looks like a silver handgun. The troopers also talk about the fact that the road they're on, which is Amesbury Road, comes to a dead end where Mr. Brown will have to go left or right on Bear Hill Road. What happens is when Mr. Brown reaches the intersection, you'll hear the helicopter report that he spun out. And about 18 seconds later, it's reported that Mr. Brown has hit a tree and shots have been fired. The report about shots fired actually happens after the shooting has already taken place. You'll see how the helicopter circles around. You'll briefly see the intersection where the shooting take place. And then the helicopter circles over the area where Mr. Brown's truck is. At that point, you'll see several armed Massachusetts State Troopers approaching Mr. Brown's truck, which has crashed into a tree. Last, you'll see those troopers approach the truck and remove Mr. Brown and handcuff him. You'll hear that EMS was requested. However, at that point, Mr. Brown was already deceased.
Kansas City is a local on call to emergency.
Three Road.
View of the scene right now.
Watch the crossfire on the ground. Watch the crossfire.
That's the last clip we have to play for you today. As we said in the beginning, the entire recording will be available for release at the end of this presentation. Next, we'll show you a diagram of the shooting scene and explain what the Massachusetts State Troopers who fired at Mr. Brown told us occurred there. This is an overhead view of the intersection of Amesbury Road with Bear Hill Road in Newton, where the incident took place. This diagram reflects how the scene looked when the New Hampshire State Police Major Crime Unit arrived there that night and documented it. These black colored vehicles are the Massachusetts State Police cruisers. The brown colored vehicle in the lower left corner up against the tree is Mr. Brown's truck. When Mr. Brown got to the intersection, he turned left, spun out, and lost control of his truck. The red line shows you the route that he took into the intersection. He came into the intersection, spun out, and ended up in this black spot here next to the tree. The blue line shows you the path that Mr. Brown took when he left the intersection and headed in the direction of the troopers who were on the side of the road. These red and blue marks came from the marks that Mr. Brown left in the road from his tires that had been shredded. So these are marks left by his rim in the road, rims in his road. Those dug into the pavement and allowed there to be a record of his path in and out. Based on those marks and the witness statements, we know that when Mr. Brown drove in, he spun out, ended up on the side of the road, stopped briefly, and when he did, he's actually facing the troopers who followed him into the intersection. At that point, Massachusetts State Troopers Michael Caranfa, Robert Holland, George Katsarakis, and Daniel Pertel stopped their cruisers at the intersection and got out. As those troopers got out, they were aware that Mr. Brown had been shooting at troopers during this pursuit. They'd also heard the information in the bolo that Mr. Brown was wanted for sexual assault and had threatened suicide by cop. Based on that, all four troopers got out of their vehicles with their weapons drawn. As he got out, Trooper Holland shouted at Mr. Brown to show them his hands. Instead of doing that, though, Mr. Brown revved his engine and accelerated towards where the troopers were. Troopers Holland and Pertell were in this area right here as Mr. Brown drove forward to where they were. As he drove forward, both of those troopers told investigators that they believed that Mr. Brown would run them over or shoot at them. At that point, both troopers fired several shots at Mr. Brown using the department-issued 45 caliber handguns. As that is happening, troopers Carantha and Katsarakis were outside their cruisers as well. And they were located over here near these two other cruisers. As Mr. Brown drove by those two troopers, both troopers saw Mr. Brown in his truck with his right hand extended out towards them. Trooper Katsarakis told investigators that he was actually able to see a shiny colored pistol in Mr. Brown's hand, and that's because his headlights from his cruiser were facing at Mr. Brown's truck as he drove by. At that point, both of those troopers believed that Mr. Brown would shoot at them, so they fired several shots at him with their department-issued .223 caliber rifles. Mr. Brown drove past those four troopers, off the road, down the road, and then hit that tree. As he did that, Trooper Carantha saw a shadow in the truck and what appeared to be an arm extended out. Seeing that, Trooper Carantha believed that Mr. Brown was going to shoot at them again. And at that point, that trooper fired one or two more shots until the movement from Mr. Brown stopped. No other shots were fired after that. Next, as you saw in the video, a group of Massachusetts State Troopers approached the truck and they removed Mr. Brown and handcuffed him. Last, as you heard, EMS was called, but at that point, Mr. Brown was already deceased from a gunshot wound. After the incident ended, the New Hampshire Attorney General's office was notified about the shooting, as well as the State Police Major Crime Unit. And together with the State Police Major Crime Unit, we began investigating the incident to determine if the Massachusetts State Troopers who used deadly force that night did so in accordance with the law. As part of the investigation, the shooting scene was examined, physical evidence was collected, audio and visual recordings were reviewed, police reports were obtained from the Presque Isle, Maine Police Department, and the four Massachusetts State Troopers who discharged their firearms that night were interviewed. All four of those troopers agreed to interviews and were fully cooperative. In addition, the command staff at the Massachusetts State Police was fully cooperative and extremely helpful in arranging those interviews and providing us with the reports and information we needed. Those interviews and reports painted a consistent picture of the danger that Mr. Brown posed that night to the public and the troopers who were pursuing him on June 15, 2017. In addition to those interviews, reports were gathered, those were reviewed as well, and also the New Hampshire State Police Major Crime Unit collected evidence in this case. From the shooting scene, they collected 21 spent rifle casings and 9 handgun casings from the two areas where the four Massachusetts State Troopers were standing at the intersection at Bear Hill Road, when they fired at Mr. Brown. During a search of Mr. Brown's truck, a 9mm semi-automatic pistol was found in the front passenger compartment. You'll notice that the silver finish on that pistol is consistent with what Trooper Katsarakis told the investigators during the interview, which is that he could see Mr. Brown holding his arm out with a shiny pistol in his hand as he crossed in front of those troopers. The person who reported that pistol stolen on June 15th told the police that it was loaded with 15 live rounds when Mr. Brown took it. When the state police recovered it from the stolen truck, the gun was empty. The fact that the gun is empty is consistent with Mr. Brown firing up to 15 shots at the Massachusetts State Troopers who were pursuing him that night. As you heard on the audio, Mr. Brown fired at least 6 separate times at the troopers. In addition to the pistol, the New Hampshire State Police Major Crime Unit also recovered a note in the truck that was from Mr. Brown's mother. That note was given to him just a few days before this incident. This is the note, and I'll read what it says. "Mike, just want you to know I've always loved you, no matter what. You're my son. If I don't see you again, I'll always hold you close to my heart. Take care. Love, Mom." The idea expressed in that note, that Mr. Brown's mother might never see him again, is consistent with Mr. Brown's statement before the pursuit, when he said that he did not intend to be captured and did not intend to go back to prison, and that he would die by suicide by cop. As for Mr. Brown's injuries, an autopsy was performed which confirmed that he'd suffered some non-life-threatening injuries in the car crash at the end of the pursuit. The autopsy also confirmed that Mr. Brown was wounded one time by gunfire and died as a result of a rifle shot to the back of his neck. The rifle round that was recovered from that wound was consistent with the rifles being used by either Trooper Caranfa or Trooper Katsarakis that night. Testing on a sample of Mr. Brown's blood confirmed that he had the inactive and active components of marijuana in his bloodstream, as well as amphetamines and methamphetamines at the time of the incident. Using all that evidence gathered during the investigation, the New Hampshire Attorney General's Office reviewed the Massachusetts State Trooper's conduct in this case in light of New Hampshire's law of self-defense. New Hampshire's laws regarding self-defense permit private citizens and law enforcement officers to use deadly force to protect themselves and others when they reasonably believe that deadly force is necessary to protect themselves and others from the imminent use of deadly force. In this case, the Attorney General has concluded that all four Massachusetts State Troopers in this incident who used deadly force were legally justified in doing so. From the start, Mr. Brown made it clear that he had no intention of being taken alive and that he was willing to use deadly force to avoid being taken in. That deadly force included his erratic driving with a stolen pickup truck, as well as the numerous shots he took at the Massachusetts State Troopers that night who were trying to capture him. Mr. Brown had many chances to end the pursuit peacefully, but instead, he chose to escalate an already dangerous situation to the point where it became reasonable for four law enforcement officers to conclude that deadly force was necessary. For that reason, New Hampshire Attorney General Gordon J. McDonald has determined that Massachusetts State Troopers Michael Caranfa, Robert Holland, George Katsarakis, and Daniel Pertell were all legally justified when they used deadly force against Michael Brown on June 15, 2017. Therefore, no criminal charges will be filed against those officers in connection with this case, and the criminal investigation into this matter will be closed.
So it's time for a limited number of questions. Yes.
Are the four troopers back at work?
Colonel?
Sure. Yes. I'm sorry, I didn't hear the question.
Are the four troopers back at work?
Four troopers are back at work, yes.
Were they ever on duty or anything?
When they're involved in a situation like that, we relieve them from duty. And we have them evaluated. They were evaluated and they wish to return to full duty.
So they were out for being evaluated for a few days?
Yes.
Colonel, if you could, the description that we've been given, you speak on behalf of your men, the description we've been given about how this car is coming at these officers, how these troopers, how stretched arm we've gotten. I guess, what does that tell you in your mind, if you're not investing, if you're not investigating in your men, about what they had to do or were they justified?
Well, it's always a, as everybody can understand, a difficult situation. But they're making split-second decisions. And our policy is such that it allows us to defend ourselves or others in that type of a situation. So. I felt that they used the objectively reasonable force in the circumstances, and that's the judgment. And we will be conducting an administrative investigation. We've held off until this investigation in New Hampshire has been conducted. But I must say that throughout this entire incident, I believe those troopers acted professionally and use the best judgment, both tactically, in that they didn't pursue that vehicle southbound. When the vehicle was traveling the wrong direction, as part of our policy, we won't do that. They adhered to that. We had I thought excellent communication throughout with our air wing. And as you heard different voices in there, this pursuit is being commanded at our troop headquarters. So that's how these pursuits are not just randomly conducted. We have oversight. We're asking things. They're reporting what the traffic pattern is, what the weather situation is. And when we feel that those situations don't are not conducive to the safety of the public, we'll terminate those pursuits. So all in all, I think they did a tremendous job. I'm very proud of them.
I just want to follow up what the Colonel said about your question about what happened at the intersection. I think it's important to note that it's not just what happened at the intersection that factored into those troopers' minds. They had the BOLO to keep in mind, which is a suspect who was wanted for sexual assault, who was armed with a pistol, and who had made it clear he didn't want to be taken alive. You had a pursuit that went on for about 30 minutes. We had somebody who fired six separate times at the troopers, and as you heard, expended probably close to 15 rounds. So all that is in their minds before they even get to the intersection, where he's non-compliant, races at them, and shows a weapon. So again, we look at the totality of the circumstances, not just what happened in New Hampshire, but what happened before that, and that factored into those troopers' decisions that deadly force was necessary. And again, the Attorney General has concluded that it was necessary. So I think on one of those clips you hear when it's the pit maneuver. So it's when you see the close-up where the cruiser is behind Mr. Brown on the back roads. And he talks about the fact they tried to pit him. And I think if you listen to that clip again, you'll hear him say, I took rounds. I might have taken some rounds to my windshield. I fired back, but I didn't hit him. That trooper fired back five times through his own windshield to try and hit Mr. Brown when Mr. Brown is firing at him. And that's because the trooper is very close to him at that point, trying to bump him and stop the pursuit. That's happening in Massachusetts, but it was clear that trooper did fire back at that point, but was unable to stop Mr. Brown.
That was the only situation where a traffic fired before the intersection?
That's correct, yep. Prior to that, as you saw in the video, the troopers were coordinating about trying to stay back out of gunfire range. One of the other things they did is they were using their spotlights to try and illuminate Mr. Brown's the cab on his truck to make it harder for him to aim at them. And as you heard, he's trying very hard to aim at them. He's shooting out the side window and the center back window as well, trying to hit those troopers.
Jeff, when the troopers were approaching, when they handcuffed them, they couldn't, I'm sure they didn't know it at the time, but you believe he was deceased before they handcuffed him?
Yes. Yes. I mean, troopers weren't even sure at that point. One of the troopers said that he thought that Mr. Brown may have committed suicide at that point, so it wasn't clear who would hit him. But obviously their first priority was to approach the vehicle. You saw that once they removed him, they cleared to make sure there wasn't anybody else in the vehicle, got him on the ground, handcuffed him. EMS was called pretty quickly, but at that point he was deceased.
Were there any, maybe you said this in interesting, but were there any New Hampshire police that were involved in any of this call?
No. So up until the last minute and a half, this was a Massachusetts pursuit. What happened is once he crossed over, he was a mile and a half into New Hampshire. New Hampshire police officers were moving in that direction. But again, it ended within a minute and a half. Again, prior to that, it was all in Massachusetts.
We have time for one more question, if someone has one. Yes?
Jeff, maybe can you just explain, and I'm sorry if I'm confused, but
that's okay.
When we're seeing the troopers on the ground with their guns drawn, is Mr. Brown already deceased?
Yes, so that's the aftermath of the shooting. As I explained, you don't. And that's because, as you saw, the helicopter swinging around. By the time it swings around, the shooting's already done. And what the helicopter does is it records some of the aftermath. And so you see, what you probably couldn't see, is there were a group of troopers across the street as well, covering those troopers, which is why you heard someone say, watch the crossfire on the ground. So they are approaching because they don't know if he's alive or dead at that point. They know he's armed with a deadly weapon, he's used it. They approach to clear the truck and remove him. And that's what you're seeing. Actually, once he's crashed, it's ended at that point. So the shots fired announcement actually comes after shots have been fired. That's somebody reporting back to headquarters saying shots have been fired out here. But the time frame between when he hits that intersection and when it ends, meaning the shots have been fired, is probably less than 15 seconds. All right?
And Thank you. I'm going to stay around and hand copies of the materials available to all of you. Thank you, and thank you for being here.